Hey, let's make some creepy spider webs. You'll need a hot glue gun and a large silicone mat and an air compressor. I'm gonna make sure my hot glue gun is positioned right over the nozzle of my air gun here, and then I will put a stream of glue in front of it and then blast it with air. Ooh, and it comes right off the silicone. Spider webs! Quick thank you to Surebonder for sponsoring the video and providing the glue guns and the hot glue we used to make this. We'll have more on them in a little bit. Halloween is just a couple weeks away, and we've got three costume projects for you today, along with a couple of fantastic Halloween costume tips. We had a lot of fun with our Halloween video last year, so this year we're doing three good projects with basic tools and materials. Of course, we're always looking for more fun costume ideas, so if you have a fairly easy and basic but impressive Halloween costume idea, let us know in the comments so that we can get great ideas, but so everyone else can get good ideas too. All right, let's get started on the first costume. I can't think of a creepier, better costume for Halloween than a little Lord of the Rings action with a Nazgul. Big old black robes, giant hood, no face. It's gonna be exciting. And for it, I need a pattern for my robe. You might be able to find a robe that looks good off the shelf. I could not, so I bought an imitation or knockoff Harry Potter robe. And I'm gonna use this to make my pattern for the Ringwraith. But first I'll put it on and see if we need to alter it at all. That's pretty good. I'll have to check it against the reference, but the hood covers a lot of my face, which is nice. This will be closed, but my face will be completely obscured. The sleeves look pretty good, although I may make them hang a little bit lower and maybe just a touch longer. And it'll probably end up being all frayed on the end too, so I want some extra material to work there. But yeah, now that I know what I want to change on this, we can lay it out and start making our pattern. For our fabric, I went with a linen rayon blend. It's got a nice coarse weave to it, which I think would look really great for the Nazgul. I can lay it all out and start tracing some of my pattern parts off of that robe that I bought. Got my fabric doubled up here so I can cut out both halves of my hood at the same time. Now I could rip this robe apart, but I'm gonna try to do this without destroying it, in case maybe I want that again. We're also gonna make a couple of alterations. So I want the top of the head here to be a little bit more rounded, and then this neck part here, I wanna remove a little bit here to sort of change the shape of the hood. Got this cool chalk trace line thing for doing lines on fabric. It's really, really useful. And I'm gonna trace a little bit outside of my piece to allow for the seams and also for making a hem around the front of it there. So I'm gonna give myself like 3/4 of an inch or so. And I'm also gonna mark that I want the neck to kind of end here as opposed to down here. I'm gonna sort of cut this corner a little bit to get it a little bit more rounded on the top of my head there. I also have my 1, 2, 3 blocks here as pattern weights. What can't 1, 2, 3 blocks do? And I just want to connect the bottom there, but I also want like an inch. Actually, let me get my ruler. Got this crazy ruler so I can add the bottom here and add a little bit of an allowance as well. Okay, now I can get those out. Just pinning these together so that they don't move while I shift these bits around. Next, I'm gonna get my fabric-only scissors. I cannot be more clear. These are only for fabric. You wanna make sure you don't use these scissors on anything that could damage them, including paper. Paper can dull a pair of scissors like this. That's why I only use them for fabric, and that's why I get mad at anyone who tries to use them for anything else. Got my hood all cut out here, and it's time to put it all together, but not gonna use my sewing machine. Instead, I'm gonna use hot glue. Sometimes you're in a hurry, or you don't have your sewing machine nearby, or you need to make a quick fix to a fabric costume, you can totally use hot glue to put it back together. I'm going with these black hot glue sticks here. They work great on fabric, and they will blend in nicely with the dark fabric that I have. I'm gonna make a little sandwich here, and I'm working in small sections. I really wanna make sure that hot glue gets driven through the fabric and there's plenty of it there. So I'm doing like a 4-inch chunk there and then carefully pressing it down, although it's, I do feel the glue coming through, it's not burning my fingers. And then I'm gonna go over the other side and again, really drive that glue down through the fibers. The goal is to get this glue to stick to the glue we put on the inside, both on that side and on the other side. And working on the silicone mat means I can set this piece down like that, and it's not gonna stick to the surface. Once that cools down, and it cools down pretty quickly, we should be able to peel it off of the mat and keep working. Now I'm just gonna continue that down the whole seam, down the back of the hood. The face opening and neck opening down here, I am not gluing those together. Not that I would ever make a mistake like that. Next step after the hot glue is to see if it's turned out okay. These pins are just holding everything together, so I don't need those anymore. And I should be able to just flip this inside out and have a hood I can put on my head. See how I feel about the change I made to the back of it here? It's pretty good. This comes down and then these will come straight down like that. And I think we're in pretty good shape. What do you think, Britt? All right, let's move on to the next part. Oh, look, I've already started to weather it. I've just been putting together everything the same way you do it if you were sewing it. Of course, I'm just using hot glue. And we also found out that working on the silicone mat works really well, like that. But then having another one here that I can lay down so that when I put glue on the top here, I can really push it into the fabric like that. And then I can flip it over and it's not gonna stick to the fabric like that. I can really press that in and then I can glue the other side and fold it down and press the other side. And I can use this silicone mat there if I don't wanna stick to the top of it. That seems to work out really well. I think it's time to add the sleeves. Bad. Got the hood clipped on here temporarily to see kind of where we're headed, and things are looking pretty good. The hot glue is holding up. The hood here, I think, it comes to a point here on the, I guess, the lapel, and I think I want to alter this and curve it down a little bit so that this part of the hood just goes down the front of the robe. So I'm going to take this apart, trim that, and then attach the hood. There's our hood all attached. Now, originally I thought I would have the robe just closed in the front here, but to give myself a little more room, we're gonna add a panel in the front. And that panel is right here, just more of our linen fabric. I actually ran out. We had 4 yards of fabric for this. That might've been a little bit not enough, so maybe 5 yards would have been better. But I took the scraps and I glued them together. There will be a seam down the middle, but this is gonna look all wrinkly anyway. This is gonna go on here, and I think I only wanna attach it in a couple spots, and I'm gonna add some snaps so I can take it off. These are sew-on snaps, but I put a little hot glue on the back of them to tack them down where I want them to go so they don't move at all when I'm doing my hand stitching. That way it can flop around and it'll stay exactly where I need it. Our front panel is all installed. It looks pretty good. My seams, actually these hot glue seams, I gotta tell you, they look pretty fantastic. Although I wouldn't iron them, that would probably pull them apart. I will say, if you have a sewing machine, that's definitely gonna be quicker than using the hot glue, but if you were gonna hand stitch it, the hot glue is much faster. And I'm really impressed with how good those seams look. Hood's looking good too. The only real critique is this is far too clean, so it's time to weather it. This is the opening on the hood, the cut edge, and I want it to look all crazy and frayed, so I have some 100 grit sandpaper here, and I'm just gonna rip the crap out of this. It's gonna have all kinds of dangly bits. And I'm also gonna go over the flat areas and just really rough them up. Like, this thing is thousands of years old, right? Or it's supposed to be anyway. So I'm just gonna do this over the whole thing, and I especially wanna make sure that the open edges don't look like they were cut out yesterday with a pair of scissors. Everything I do, I end up sanding it, don't I? If you really wanna mangle an edge, a super heavy duty wire brush like this will really rip some threads out. Yeah. The robe is looking sufficiently ratty and sort of torn up, and I really like how it's looking. Problem is, it's far too clean. I think it should be a lot more dusty. As dirty as my shop floor is, it didn't actually dirty up the clothing all that much. So I have a little bit of Fuller's Earth, and I'm gonna go in by hand and add my own grime. I'm also gonna put on a dust mask. I don't wanna breathe this in. We can't see the Nazgul's face, so we need to obscure my face somehow, and I have this sheer black cloth that I use on helmets to cover eye holes and to hide your face. And I think just one layer might not be quite enough. So if I double it up, let's see, like that. That should be enough so that my face is completely gone. Can you see me, Britt?
Nope.
Great. Got my sheer fabric cut to shape here, and now I'm gonna attach it to my hood. And in keeping with the theme of this build, I'm gonna use hot glue. I'm gonna start by tacking it down a little bit and seeing how it looks. That way I don't have to remove a ton of hot glue if it looks bad. Got my face cover there kind of tacked in. I had to move it a little bit and figure out the placement, but I think we're in a good place. And then the bottom of it, I'm just gonna have it hanging free, but I wanna like cut it up with my fabric scissors and kind of fray it a bit so it looks all ragged and blends with the rest of it. Trying to get all the bits to kind of come to little points. Just a little bit of sandpaper. It doesn't take much. It's a very delicate fabric, but I do want to rough this up a little bit more so it doesn't have those clean cut edges. Do I look pretty yet? Just a couple more things to do. Ta-da! I realize I'm smiling and you have no idea. If you ask me, $8 for a sword rain stick combo is a great bargain. I got this at the Halloween store. It was super cheap. It's hollow, it's flimsy, and it looks kind of weird, but it actually looks an awful lot like one of the Nazgul swords, so I'm gonna use it for my Nazgul costume. The main thing I don't like about this is the really uniform pitted texture that they put on the blade. So I'm gonna sand this, Bondo it, add my own texture. After filling, sanding, and priming the sword, it's looking pretty great. Most of the weird pitted texture is filled in. Now I wanna go back in with my rotary tool and add a little bit of that pitted texture, but make it less uniform, make it look a little more pretty. The bit in here is rounded, so I can leave some little round gouges, and I wanna add pitting to make it look like the blade has sort of started to deteriorate over time. And I think that's what they wanted to do with their big circles they put in there. It's just a little ham-fisted. So I'm gonna go in with a finer hand and spruce it up a little bit. Added my little pits there and I think they look pretty great. To sort of blend those and add a little more texture, I've got more 100 grit sandpaper here and I'm just gonna scratch the surface. This thing is really old, it's got thousands of battles, it's gonna be scratched. So I'm just gonna go over all of this, and then I think I'm ready to do some paint. Time for a quick and dirty paint job, starting with a base coat of just black acrylic paint. I'm gonna water it down a bunch and just scrub it all over the surface. This will be our, almost like our primer coat. And all our metallics will go on top of that. Our black is dry, and the next step is gonna be some silver, and I wanna darken it a little bit. So I just have some of the black paint I used, and I'm darkening this silver. And then I'm gonna do some dry brushing. A couple layers of it, actually, starting with this darker, more like gunmetal silver. So let's remove a bunch of that, and then just start dry brushing. That already looks nice and metallic, too. Now I have just the silver loaded up, no black, and I'm doing the very brightest highlights. So I'm a little more surgical with this one, just calling out all the edges and maybe adding a couple of like scratches, like more than a couple, but you know what I mean. Adding some scratches and calling out all the highlights and edges. Blade's looking good. Now it's time for the handle. I'm gonna wrap it in a little bit of our fabric from the robe. I'm gonna attach this down to the plastic with hot glue. I made sure to sand this surface so that the hot glue has something to stick onto. And then I'm just gonna loosely wrap this around and just keep tacking it down every pass. Great thing about this is it can totally be sloppy. It doesn't need to be like a perfect elven handle wrap. Like that. There we go. I think that's gonna do it for my sword. That's all the effort I wanna put into this, just a couple of hours, and I'm pretty happy with how it turned out. We've got just a couple more things to put together for this costume to make it complete, including some clothing. And this is just black clothing of any kind, long sleeve, black shirt here, some sort of athletic thing that I'll have under all of this so you don't see my skin coming through on my arms. And especially around here, I don't want anything other than black. And then same thing, I have some black pants and some black shoes that are already on my feet. The other thing to really bring this home are the gloves. You could just go with black gloves, but you could also make yourself some Nazgul gauntlets, which I have already done. We have a video on how we built these. Actually, that's over on Tessage's channel. I had a chance to build these with my hero, Adam Savage, which was amazing. And then we have a painting video that shows how to put all of these together, including free patterns. So we'll link to those videos down below if you wanna make yourself some Nazgul gauntlets to go with your costume. Other than that, I think I have all the pieces I need to put this whole thing together. I'm gonna go put it on. Here's the whole Nazgul costume put together. Of course, you know it's silly old me under here, but come Halloween night, it's gonna be more like, yeah, just like that. A great practice if you're looking for costume ideas is to hit up thrift stores. Last year, we did a Harry Potter style wizard costume that was sourced entirely from a thrift store. We also have a bunch of other fun projects like a sort of generic Star Wars smuggler costume. And if you'll remember, I made a cyberpunk costume. Again, with all stuff sourced from thrift stores. They're great if you need garments or shoes or boots or gloves, and they even have a whole bunch of Halloween stuff around this time of year. It's totally worth going there and just checking out what they have to offer, see if anything sort of sparks your imagination. The next costume is a Ghostbusters outfit. I'm actually surprised it's taken me this long to make one because I've already made pretty much all of the accessories. Most of what I have here was store-bought. In fact, like the belt, these elbow pads, the flight suit, those were all picked up off of Amazon. The patches I actually got sent to me from my buddy Elton. Thank you very much, Elton. I'm finally putting them to use. But you can also get things like this on Amazon or on Etsy if you keep your eye out. Over here, you can see we have a couple more things, including stuff from the Halloween store. They just sell Ghostbuster rubber gloves. fantastic. And of course they have all their accessories like the PKE meter and the ghost trap you can get there, and touch it up to make it look really cool. That's what I did last year with these two pieces. Then of course there's some other things here like this hose and some foam I'm gonna use to fabricate some things from scratch, and things like my boots. Yes, they are not the correct boots, but these are the boots that I have. And since I'm making the Duran character, then I get to say that he wears these boots. Most of the work we're gonna do will be to the flight suit. And this looks almost exactly like the same one used in the movie. I don't know if it is or not, but it's like perfect. Store-bought, ready to go. All we have to do is add a couple of things to it, starting with our patches. The name patch needs to go on there, and mine needs some Velcro on it, so I'll sew that on with a machine. But I'm gonna start by hand stitching my Ghostbusters logo on the right upper arm. First step was to try the suit on, of course, make sure it fits. I put the elbow pad on here temporarily so that we could position the patch in a good spot up there, and I'm happy with that. It's pinned on, now I can take it off and sew it. One of my favorite tools for sewing, a pair of needle nose pliers. This is pretty thick, kind of hard to get through, so the pliers help a lot. Our patch is just getting hand stitched on here. Nothing fancy, just making sure I stitch through the fabric of the vest and get a good chunk of the edge here, and I'm using red thread to match the patch there. And this is I can't quite push it through, so that's why I have my needle nose pliers here to help me out. And there we go. So this is semi-permanent. You could snip this off if you needed this flight suit for something else. But what else would I need this for besides busting ghosts? There's our arm patch, looking fantastic. And over here on our flight suit, there's already a bit of Velcro, and I have the opposing side here because I keep a lot of Velcro on hand, and that needs to get attached to my patch. As a temporary bond, I'm gonna hot glue this down. Hot glue is pretty good at holding this stuff, but it actually doesn't stick very well to the backside of this part of the Velcro. So I'm gonna use this to tack it down, and then I'll sew along those edges there. Of course, you could hand sew it, but I've got my sewing machine out here so I can do it super quickly. I think I missed part. I might have to do that again. It's cool. There we go. Very nice. That is done. Now there's a weird leg tube thing I need to navigate. This leg tube thing was used for who knows what in the context of Ghostbusters, but I'm gonna add it. This is what it actually looked like in the movie, and it even kind of looks like it's made out of foam, so that's what I'm gonna use. And they just sewed it right onto their pant leg. Probably gonna do the same thing. For the actual tube, this is just some vinyl tubing from the hardware store. I used it for something that dyed it black. Doesn't matter, it's gonna work great for us. I'm starting with just a piece of foam here. Then I'm gonna wrap around my tube with a little bit of hot glue. And then we'll work from there. Not sure how well this will stick to the vinyl tubing, but we'll find out. The next layer is going to wrap around that one, and I'll just sort of see roughly about how long that needs to be right there. And I'll do the same thing. There we go. That's all together. There's a seam there, but I'll just make sure that's on the bottom so that we won't see it. Now this foam will be used to make the sort of base for it. And I'm thinking maybe the inside circle here. Okay, let's cut out a circle. Tell you what, you get into prop and costume making, you end up cutting out a lot of circles. There we go, one circle. And then this will get attached there. I think I'll just use my rotary tool to clean up some of these edges and then glue it all together. More hot glue for the assembly. I'm gonna make sure this cools completely before I let it go. This is all gonna be hanging on that, so I wanna make sure it's as sturdy as possible. Since I'm gonna stitch this with thread, I wanna use something a little sturdier under it. So I have this nylon webbing that my stitching should go through. I'm just gonna hot glue this down. This way, hopefully the thread, if it does rip through the foam, will stop at the webbing. Just gonna singe the edges, the cut edges on that nylon, so they don't fray everywhere. There we go. It's hard to figure out what color that is. It looks like it was meant to be some sort of like metallic something that got lots of slime on it. I'm just gonna paint it a dark silver and then weather it. I think that'll look pretty great. Just have some acrylic paints here, some silver and some black mixed together, and I'm gonna wipe as much off as I can and just dry brush this, just leaving little bits of metallic paint on there. The picture there, it's weird because it does look very green, but sometimes, you know, reference images you get from the internet, they're not color corrected and they may have some sort of tint to the whole image that really throws off what the color is supposed to be. This is dry enough. There we go. To attach this, it actually goes right here on the left pant leg, and in the reference picture, you can even see the pocket, the same pocket right here. So that goes right there, and I'm gonna stitch it, but I'm gonna pay special care to not stitch all the way through my pocket and have it bind up the pocket, because I would really like to still use that. I'll tell you what, this is kind of a pain in the butt. Sewing already isn't my favorite thing, but it's kind of cool thinking that someone in like 1982 or 1983, when they were making these original costumes, was doing the exact same thing. I think that's pretty cool. Prop maker, time travel, if you will. There we go. I cut this to length and punched a hole in it, and this is the back of my costume, just below the belt, and I'm gonna stitch that right there. That way, it'll look like this just goes under the belt. Got my hose all connected to my flight suit. There's only one more thing to do. I need to weather this thing. I've got a spray bottle with a little bit of water in it. Just dump some coffee in there. And I'm gonna use that to make some spots on here just look a little dirty and darker. I'm just spritzing in areas where like sweat would accumulate and make the cloth a little darker, like around the neck, around the armpit. I'm gonna go around the elbow and knee pits. I just want it to look like it's been something that this Ghostbuster has been wearing for a long time and just accumulating human filth on it. It just looks wet now, but when it dries, it should be a little bit darker, and I can go over it as many times as I want. If the coffee doesn't work, or it doesn't get as dark as you want, you could use acrylic paints. I just happen to have some coffee. My coffee, it's still drying, but it's pretty subtle, so I'm gonna go back over it again, but I'm gonna put a little bit of black acrylic paint in here so we have some more pigment to work with, and it should be a little more grimy and dirty. I added quite a lot of paint and I don't know how it's gonna look, so I'm doing my first test kind of on the bottom of the leg here, because this will get tucked into the boot, you won't see it, just in case this is too much. And it looks like a lot when you put it on there, but remember this is very diluted, and when it dries it won't be nearly as dark. I like this an awful lot, but I think I'm gonna dilute it just a little bit more and then go hog wild on the rest of this thing. While I'm dirtying up my pants here, I'd like to tell you about our sponsor, Surebonder, who made this video possible. They're a family-owned business. Started in 1968, they sell hot glue guns, hot glue sticks, staple guns, rivet, tools, and more. We used a ton of their hot glue stuff in this video, and it was really useful and helpful. It works on so many of the materials we like to use, like fabric or EVA foam. And I really like the accessories they have, like the wider nozzles or the longer nozzles. Makes custom work super easy. That Ultra Series hot glue gun has an auto shut off. After 30 minutes of non-use, it will turn itself off, which is awesome because sometimes I forget to unplug it. It also has a safety fuse and it can use high or low temperature hot glue, which is amazing. I didn't get a chance to use it on any of these projects, but they also have a staple gun that's just amazing with a trigger fire option. I had to go get it and show you. This thing is just so neat. You set it to trigger, and then when you pull it, it primes it, and then you can just pull the trigger like that, and it staples it right down. This is awesome for shop projects and building things really quickly. Anyway, you can pick up any of their great stuff at surebonder.com with the discount code props20 for a limited time and get some money off of your purchase. You can also find them in your local retailers, but that discount code only works online. So thank you again to Surebonder for the wonderful tools and materials and for sponsoring this video. That is the jumpsuit all sorted, nice and dirty. Got a good layer of grime on there. Now for some more of the accessories. This is just assembling all the stuff I bought. So I have some technically knee pads, but they're gonna go on my elbow, and I have my belt. So these will all get weathered before they go on me. Same way as the jumpsuit. Sort of use that to clean up my mess. All the Ghostbusters seem to have a keychain on their belt with a little loopy thing, so you can buy one of these, or I just made this super quick out of a piece of leather and this hook. That's just gonna hang on there, and then I can put it on. Hey, there we go. I got my keychain loop here, you know, for the keys to Ecto-1. Although the Ghostbusters haven't let me drive it yet. Someday. Elbow pads need to be dirtied up too, especially like this is where the pit of your elbow is. So a lot of sweat's gonna accumulate there. That should be all dirty. And then the back of it, I'm just gonna spritz with all sorts of fun grime. And I think my Ghostbuster is gonna be the kind of Ghostbuster that likes to roll up his sleeves. Stylish like. Next is the boots. And I believe the originals were like Vietnam era combat boots. I don't have any of those and I couldn't find any. So I am going to settle for my motorcycle boots for now anyway. And then when I get some combat boots, I'll swap those out. This is the base Ghostbuster outfit, and you could go out on Halloween just like this, but you also have the option of some wonderful accessories. Starting with gloves, the Halloween store just sells these, and they are just rubber gloves, but they have Ghostbuster logo on them, so I bought them. You could make your own if you want. You could wear them or just tuck them in your belt. I think that's what I'm gonna do. There we go. You know, for handling ectoplasm. The other accessories are things that we've built in the past, starting with our PKE meter. This is a toy we got from the Halloween store, and we have a video on how we took the toy and made it look a lot more movie realistic. It does all the features, and it's got a clip on the back so I can put it right here next to my gloves. Same story with the trap, again from the Halloween store. We did a little work to make it look more realistic, and we have a video for that too. That can go on my other side. There we go, it's a little bulky, but I consider it carry-on. And now let's talk about the last accessory, the 800-pound nuclear accelerator in the room, the Proton Pack. Now you may consider, if you're gonna go out partying on Halloween, to not carry around a heavy thing on your back because it is cumbersome. But if you want one, and who doesn't? You've got some great options, and we have a pair of videos for either option. This one right here is the sort of full package. This has lights and sounds. We built it with my friend Garrick Backer from No One's Designs, and we have a video on that one. If you're gonna crank out a build like this, it may take a few months. So if Halloween's just around the corner, this might not be the best option. But the other great option is the Halloween store version. It's a little bit smaller, but it's basically all done, and you can modify it as much as you want to fit your Ghostbuster, and we have a video on that too. I'm gonna put this one on and go bust some ghosts. We live in astonishing times. If you visited a Halloween specific store like Spirit Halloween, they pop up in October every year. They have just a king's ransom of wonderful toys and costumes and pieces you can source. We went there and checked out a bunch of really great stuff, got a lot of fun inspiration. They have props like Pip-Boy that you could repaint. They have all sorts of weapons that are super creepy and fun, and a lot of licensed stuff like Overwatch and a bunch of Marvel things. There is, of course, a whole section for Fortnite and a bunch of Ghostbuster stuff, which I like a lot. We also have a ton of videos that we put out on some of those repaints and modifications if you want to give it a go yourself. But I totally recommend just going there in person and shopping around and see what you think might work really well for you, and then start dreaming up ways you can modify it to make it a little better. Usually what happens is the plastic toy part of it looks really, really good, but the paint job could use a little bit of work. And repainting props is always super fun. Okay, that's enough inspiration from the Halloween store. The next costume is one of my very favorites to see at conventions. It's those lovable, wacky, inflatable T-Rex costumes, but we're gonna make ours special. We got our fella here set up on a mannequin so I can do some work on him. Now, this is fabric, and it's inflated by a fan in his side here, and then there's a 4 AA battery pack on the inside. And that's it. You just step into it, zip it up, turn on the thing, and it inflates just like this. I'm gonna climb up there and do a little work on his noggin. I am starting to make a pattern on this because I wanna make my T-Rex a costume for his head. I'm making a Batman cowl that will go over his inflated head. And I'm making a pattern the same way I would make a pattern out of foam by covering this form in tape. I just have some masking tape here. The cheaper the better. This is just gonna get pulled right off and then cut up to make our patterns. I'm just kind of vaguely covering the area where I want the pattern to exist. I don't know what it is about these silly inflatable costumes that tickle my funny bone, but I love seeing these at cons. There's always a ton of them at Dragon Con, many of them with their own costumes or even with their own custom printed skin texture. It's bonkers. They always, always make me laugh. Actually, I bet you've got a favorite costume that you see, favorite type of costume that you see that always makes you chuckle. I want to hear about it. If you have a favorite fun costume, let me know in the comments. What makes you laugh? Now, everything is covered in tape. I can come in and figure out like the edge of my cowl, where it goes around my mouth here. And then I can also figure out the edge of the eye. If his head's up like this, we want him to look very angry. And then eventually I'll cut that out for my pattern. I've got what I think are gonna be my seam lines laid out, so it's time to carefully peel this off. This sort of patterning where you cover a 3D form in tape and transfer it to something flat, you can use this for all kinds of mediums. We use it on foam all the time. In fact, we have a whole bunch of pattern making tutorials on our website. We'll have a link down below if you wanna check those out. Keep it together, there we go. I'm going to carefully start cutting this apart along that seam line. I don't want any of this tape to come apart from itself. It's not really stuck together very well, so I'm being as gentle as possible. And then once I have a piece liberated, it can go over here onto a piece of paper, and I can lay it down nice and flat. That is one piece. This will be the midline. I clearly need to fix that, but that is kind of very roughly part of a pattern shape. All right. I've got all my pieces laid out here and I can just start rough cutting them. I've also added the registration, not only just the marks, but the letters, so I know which seam goes to the other. And of course, this is the left side, and I'll just flip these over for making the right side. It's time to transfer everything to fabric, and this is a blue kind of Batman-ish color. You could go with black or all kinds of Batman colors. But this is a blue stretch sport fabric. I don't know exactly what kind it is, but it seems to be a four-way stretch. And then I've got my pattern pieces laid down, but these are doubled up so I can do the left and right side at the same time. So I'm gonna start by tracing this. Transfer my registration marks there. Should help me line everything up later, I think. Now that I've traced the outline, that looks great. I'm gonna go around it again, about a half inch off of it, and this will be my my seam allowance. And that's what I'm actually going to cut out. That way I have some room for the seams and to hem any edges that are free-floating. I took all of my parts and just rough cut them from the big piece of fabric, and now I can go in and carefully cut them out. It seems like I need to get a new sharper blade for this thing, or maybe it just has trouble with two layers of fabric. All my pieces are cut out and I can sort of flip them over. So we have the two halves there, and now we can start joining everything. You can see I have registration lines there. I didn't transfer them to this side, but I think I can line it up pretty well by eye. And I'm using these clips here instead of pins to temporarily attach this seam together. Of course, you could just use pins, but these things are so handy. I find I stab myself in the fingers a lot less with these than with pins. I'm attaching all of one side together, and I think I'll do the other side, and then I will attach the two sides together. But with this side all clipped up, I think I can go to the sewing machine and make it permanent. Now, clearly, I'm not hot gluing this. I am using the sewing machine. I think for this, especially with the stretchy fabric, this will be a lot faster and a lot cleaner. And we want that nice clean look for Batman. There we go. Slow and steady, Bill. I'm using a zigzag stitch on this so that it can, the seams can still stretch once they're all sewn. Both halves are assembled. I'm putting them together down the midline. This goes up the top of my T-Rex's head. This is my loosely fitted together cowl. Let's throw it on our T-Rex buddy, see how it looks. Oh. That worked way better on the first try than I ever dreamed possible. That's fantastic. It lines up with both his eyes on either side even. I will say the weight of it might be a problem, but we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. Now he needs a cape, and then I think I can hem everything and call it good. For the cape, I have another bit of my fabric here just folded in half. And then this is the part of my pattern that goes down the back, and this is where the cape should connect. So this, I'm gonna move it in so I have a little extra. This will be the shape I want on both sides. I'll just cut it out and use this fold as the center. Like so. And then I'll just put a little bit of a seam on that. And then the rest of the shape of my cape is kind of up to me. Just using this big old stick here as a straight edge. And that'll be the side of my cape, like that. And then we'll make a bottom down here. Just a nice simple curve on the bottom. And we started with 2 yards of fabric and we have plenty left over. I can make a cowl for myself. Look at that. That did okay on that. That was a little weird right there, but the cape is all together. And then this is synthetic. The edges don't really want to pull too much, but I think I want to hem them just to make them pretty. I got my hem all pinned up here and I use pins instead of the clips. The pins seem to keep this sort of sliding material from kind of doing this against itself and stopping from lining up. So these are all set up here and we're off to the races. My cowl and cape are pretty much put together, so let's see how it looks on our dude. Oops. Now, I've got safety pins to pin it to him. This is actually fabric. It doesn't really let a ton of air out. I can actually poke this guy with a pin, right? And I'm not gonna get a ton of air out. So I will sew this eventually to the fabric, but for now I'm just gonna pin it and see how it looks. I can see a stitch here that I need to fix. It got a little bound up there. That's not a big deal, I can fix that. Looks like I did the same thing on the other side too. So a little bit of touch-ups, but otherwise our fella's looking really great. Oh, and of course he needs little bat ears. Next step on our cowl is the ears, and I've already got started on one of them. More of our same blue fabric, but I'm gonna sort of reinforce the inside with a piece of foam like this, so it'll stand upright. I just made a quick pattern out of cardboard here. Actually, that's part of my dinosaur costume packaging to make my part here, and I'll go sew it up right now. Now I can cut just outside the seam I put down. So when I fold this inside out, that seam won't be as lumpy, I guess. There'll be less material in there. There we go. Now I can turn this inside out. Poke that middle part out there and feed my piece of foam in there. It's like putting a sock on a wet foot. Boop, 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 boop. There we go. And now I have two ears. I've tucked the rest of the fabric in there, in the ear there, and that's gonna get attached right around there. All right, cool. Now I can stitch that on probably right through the foam. I hope anyway. Let's give it a shot. The sewing machine didn't even seem to notice the foam. I had no trouble getting through that. Let's see how those ears look. Ooh, that looks okay. A little floppy, but I think once we pin this down, it won't go anywhere. It's gonna get tacked down to the dino face. There's a few more finishing touches on this fella. It's looking pretty sharp. Every Batman costume needs a Batarang, and I'm gonna make mine out of foam. This is actually a thicker piece of foam. It's about 20 millimeters thick, and that's gonna serve as the material for my Batarang. Of course, you could cut yours out of a thinner piece of foam, if that's all you got, or you could glue two pieces of foam together in a sandwich to make a thicker piece, to make a thicker material to work from. The good news is about Batarangs, is that there are so many of them, you can just make your own Batarang however you want, and no one will know which Batman it's from. Perp. I think I'll use the bandsaw to cut this out. A little bit of cleanup work. I did sand the edges to tidy them up, but I'm liking how that's looking. Great news about this Batarang is you could be done. This is a perfectly acceptable Batarang. You could add as much embellishment as you want, or you could be totally done. I'm just gonna go with my rotary tool and a 200 grit drum on here and round over the edges just to make it look a little bit more tidy. That is one super simple Batarang ready to go. Now it's time for the next accessory, the bat symbol. I picked my favorite bat symbol and printed it out at the right scale that I wanted, and I cut it apart because I need a part for the bat, which I'll do out of black foam here. And then for the oval part, I'll do out of this yellow foam here. I'm making my symbol from EVA foam. This is just from the craft store in 2 millimeters. They have all kinds of colors. Of course, I've made tons of stuff from foam. In fact, I wrote 2 books on the subject, the Foamsmith books, and I'm working on a third one right now. The first Foamsmith book was about making armor and costumes. Second one was all about making props. And the third one that I'm writing is gonna be about making helmets for your costume, all out of this same type of EVA foam. That's gonna be out in just a few months here pretty soon. But you can get Foamsmith 1 and 2 right now, right on our website. This 2 millimeter foam is great. You can just cut it out with an X-Acto knife like this. And I'm being pretty careful here. I don't wanna have to fix this later. I'm just slowly going around the edge. While I'm at it, I need to thank our Extra Credit Club. There are many ways to join, well, a couple anyway. Here on YouTube, you can be a member, or over on Patreon. We have a link down below to learn everything you need to know about the Extra Credit Club. Suffice it to say, you'll get extra content every single week in the form of vlogs from the shop, and we do build discussions every week for whatever project we're working on. In fact, this project here, I got all of my ideas, or many of them anyway, and some really good insight from the members of our Extra Credit Club. We were talking about the ideas for the Halloween video with them a couple of weeks ago while we were getting this thing all set. So thank you, Extra Credit Club, for the support and for the great ideas. We'll have a link down below where you can find out how to join. And oop, there we go. That's our circle. No need to paint it. It's already the correct color. Let's make our bat. There we go. Got my bat symbol all traced out on 2mm foam. And oh, look at that. Hey, if you're new, go ahead and hit that subscribe button and the bell, of course, because we make these videos all the time and you don't want to miss them. I'm gonna start cutting this out. Hey, there we go. Let's just set that over there and that looks pretty all right. Next step, just gonna eyeball where this goes. Center it the best I can. That looks pretty good. And then I'm gonna tape it down. I just have some masking tape here. I'm gonna tape it right on the my left side, like that. This way, I can glue the back of this and slam it down without burning my hands and accidentally touching it, and it's not gonna shift. There we go, and that will go right where it needs to go, nice and easily. Once I have this part tacked down, I can take the tape off and then do the same thing where I peel it back and I will keep doing a little bit at a time. While I'm doing this hot gluing, I'd like to thank our sponsor, Surebonder, again. They're fantastic. This is a Surebonder hot gun right here and it works awesome. If you want a wonderful discount on some of their fantastic tools, you can go to surebonder.com and use the code PROPS20 to get a discount for a limited time. So thank you, Surebonder, for sponsoring this video and making this build possible. You guys are great. I've got some pins here that I can glue down to my foam so I can pin it onto my dyno. These things are really simple. Just lay down some hot glue, and those holes in there are meant for the glue to seep through, just like that. And I'm just gonna go like so, and now those can't get out. Ta-da! Got my two pins, and I think that looks level and locked. There, inflate him a little bit. I am just putting a couple of small stitches in a couple of key locations to hold this on our buddy. I do want this to stay on, but I want to be able to take it off. So in the future, when I want to use this for some other ridiculous thing, I can just snip all of those little stitches and I have a fresh dyno. I think that ought to do it. Our cowl is secured and our bat T-Rex is all done. I'll get you next time, He-Man! Meh! Ow. Nailed it. Got my hem all pinned up. And got my hem. Ah!
His one eye!
Ha 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 ha.